Thanks for coming today. My name is Rick Telberg, and I'm pleased to introduce Hitendra Patil, the chief researcher of the Client Accounting Services Survey for CPA Trendlines. He's also director of customer success at Accountants World, which provides technology solutions exclusively to professional accountants. Today, we're going to discover the actionable insights from the Client Accounting Services Survey. Hitendra is the perfect person for the job. He's chief researcher on that project. He is director of customer success at Accountants World. He's a longtime analyst in the tax and accounting profession, and he's the author of the best-selling book, Accountaneur, published by CPA Trendlines, and you can pick up a sample of that with your downloads. He's also one of the top 100 most influential people in accounting 3 years in a row. And with that, Hitendra, I'm going to turn it over to you. Thank you very much for coming, everybody. Say hello to Hitendra Patil.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Rick, for that kind introduction, and thank you for this opportunity to be here today and share whatever I could find from that massive survey that you pulled off. That became perhaps the largest CAS survey in the profession, thousands of accountants responding to the initial one, lots of accountants giving details and firms of all sizes and all that stuff. So I'm just going to dive straight into the first initial real insight from the survey. But before that, I just wanted to make sure that we all come on the same page about what is CAS, or Client Accounting Services, or CAS. And when I say CAS, it might sound like cash, C-A-S-H. And that's what many accountants tell me, that it's more cash for them when they offer CAS. So here is what we found in the survey. Firms of all sizes responded to the survey. Firms that offered CAS, firms that do not offer CAS, all of them responded. And 90% of these responding firms, those responses came from the firm owners or the partners or the decision makers of those firms. So this is a reasonably strong insight into what's happening in the CAS market for your information and insight. So I divided that into five different categories: sole practitioners, 2 to 10 staff firms, 10, 11 to 50, 51 to 100, and more than 100. That included some of the largest firms, including national firms in the US. So this particular screen shows, per firm that does not offer CAS, that's in gray, how many firms are there that offer CAS under that firm size category? And firms that offer CAS are shown in orange. Grays are the ones that are not offering CAS. So if you look at sole practitioner, for every sole practitioner that offers CAS, 2.3 other sole practitioner firms offer CAS. One firm does not offer CAS against that 2.3. The same thing goes up significantly for 2 to 10 staff member firms. One firm not offering CAS, 8.61. 11 to 50, massive increase there. 18.32 firms offering CAS versus one not offering CAS in that firm segment size. Then 6.07 and 4.33 were larger than 100 staff firms. And, when I saw these results for the first time, I got a little perplexed as to, why this went up and then came down and what is happening. So I dived in, and that's what slicing and dicing of massive data that I did. And I found that some of the larger firms are more specific to audits and things like that. And they're very large firms. They might be very expensive when it comes to charging fees. And I also found, after reaching out to quite a few of them, that they, in fact, have partnerships with smaller firms to do the bookkeepings and accounting and things like that. So that might tell you. But the point here in this slide that brings the real importance of CAS in the market is, for every firm that does not offer CAS, there are plenty of firms that offer CAS. So this is a competitive landscape for you guys to look at based on your firm size alone. Then we looked at, okay, let's figure out what are the top services that CAS firms offer. So that's what we tried to decide. That's okay, what exactly is CAS? There are so many definitions out there in the market about, you know, what CAS is. Some people call it CAS, client accounting services, client accounting and advisory services, client accounting, client advisory services, and things like that. And there used to be this confusion. And so I did write the why, what, and how of CAS for some other publication, and that remained on the top of Google list for almost 2 years. As to you search CAS, client accounting services, that article will show on the top. So there's so much of demand on that article. And so that showed the confusion. And when we were designing this survey, we thought, okay, let's ask the professionals themselves, what exactly are you doing in CAS? So this is what came up. And this is across different sizes of firms. These are the top seven services that came under the CAS umbrella. So 86% of our bookkeeping, if you look at the right, second rightmost, 67% write up. And this was a little bit of confusion as to what people call bookkeeping versus what people call write up. And I'm going to cover that in one of the next slides. But 86% bookkeeping, financial statements, of course, 83%. Sales tax filing, this went up significantly, I think, over the last 2 years. Business advisory and consulting services, this is again one of the fastest growing internal CAS segments. A lot of accounting firms want to do this and already doing it in some shape or form. I was surprised as well as happy to see payroll tax compliance and payroll processing landing up in the top seven, because earlier, if you look at the profession's history, payroll was all pain and no gain. And the largest of the payroll service bureaus were making a lot of money out of payroll services because they had massive computers, centralized systems, and all that. But with cloud, all these technologies have started descending down onto smaller firms. And you know, you're able to utilize the power of the cloud to offer, you know, top-notch, automated, efficient payroll services. So no wonder this is picking up pretty significantly. So these form the top seven services under CAS. Now, this is what the firms that offer CAS, they said about what is CAS. Then they also came up with what are the next five top services that these firms offer. So sales tax filing versus sales tax calculation, which is processing versus compliance on sales tax side. So firms have started increasingly offering compliance as well as processing services as well as sales tax concerned. Bill payment services, now this is a segment that I see now really picking up pretty fast. And at the time of the survey, we got almost half the firms offering bill payment services, firms that offer CAS. Then outsourced and virtual CFO services, 41%. Now this is another thing that people are getting used to, meaning the firms that were typically smaller in size, they're gaining experience and expertise of what to offer as an outsourced CFO and what the processes should be, what the deliverables should be. So I fully expect this figure to go up from 41% to much, much higher. Then comes the cash flow management, 37%, which is a pretty corollary to the bill payment services that firms are offering. The moment you start going into, you know, payables, receivables, and bill payment, money movement kind of services, you also tend to get a deeper insight into the cash flow management that you can do for your clients. And that's where these services came up to be the next emerging top five, as I said. Then we looked at even more services. What are the top five other services that those firms offer? Now, you can see here, it cannot be really called as accounting per se, but those are obviously the services that clients need. Tax preparation, obviously, almost everyone is into tax preparation services. Several of the CAS firms are actually also offering tax advisory services. And when I was speaking with the accountants and I asked them this question, you know, what do you do in tax advisory services? And the CAS firms were pretty much clear as to what they meant by that is The moment you start offering cash and you start getting more and more control over the books of the clients, you start seeing a lot of insights on day-to-day transactions of those business clients, and you kind of relate them to the business decisions those clients are making or not making. And in the process, you see opportunities for tax planning and tax strategy. So cash actually kind of liberates the firms to go into the books and the brains of their clients to get into this tax advisory services. This is really a pretty interesting stuff. Personal financial planning, it seems to be rising on those sides where individual clients with good sized businesses or multiple businesses owned by the same owners, the personal financial planning is also something that we will start offering. Audit and assurance, and business valuation services. Again, the business valuation services is where accountants are advising their clients for bank funding. So, for example, for working capitals and things like that. Also, mergers and acquisitions, wherever those are a good fit for the client. So these are the five other services that came under the CAS umbrella. So now you look at top seven and top five, the 12 top services, and these five other services. I just want you to notice that number 12. So I'm going to just tell you what exactly and why. So this is it. The CAS turns out to be a leverage business model for accounting firms. And these numbers one and two apply in many situations and many different ways. Number 12 that I told you, 12 different services. CAS firms, people who responded to the survey and said they offer CAS, offer 12 services on an average. Versus those firms that do not offer CAS said they offer between 5 to 6 services. So it's almost double the number of services that CAS firms offer. So obviously double the number of services can increase the revenue of the firms as well from the same clients. And when I started telling this about, this insight, I used to get questions like, oh, but offering those additional services, wouldn't it require more resources? I can't hire more and things like that. And this 1:2 does not apply to resources at all. As I've seen several examples where the firms have utilized automation, integration, intelligent software to reduce the time it takes to process the normal work. As I have several examples where firms have doubled the number of clients without adding any staff. What happens also is in some cases I've seen the number of clients remains the same, but their income from all those clients put together for the firm increased by 75%. We have a CPA in Indiana, this accountant's world customer, who went on shifting the clients from basic services to CAS and advisory and CFO services. So their income went up significantly. This 1:2 again can be achieved using automation and intelligence. And as I said, I was talking about it before the webinar started. Automation and integration are not magic buttons, really. Those need to be integrated or involved in your firm's operating processes. You look at integrations, for example. Integration is when different software vendors, solutions you're using at your firm for different purposes, and you want to create a data set in one software, you want that to appear in other software. As long as those two softwares integrate with each other through APIs and things like that, you cut down on basic duplication of data entry. Now, integration depends upon how many softwares you're using, who are the vendors, then the internet. Fortunately, with cloud solutions, the internet at your end is out of the picture. As long as the softwares are connected through their data centers or cloud hosting, they're all connected and things will happen. Then automation is within the solution. So most of the software start becoming more and more intelligent. For example, in our case, because I see it very up close in terms of development, is our accounting software. So when we get the bank feeds in, the data comes from bank statements or bank accounts rather, And it goes into the software. The software intelligently matches with the vendors and pays and all that. It shows what's matched, what does not match. It does not match is maybe you added a new pay, a new vendor. So you define that then and there and you post. And next time the same data comes in from the same bank account, you will see even more transactions matching. I've seen between 85 to 95% reduction in manual work in bank feeds. And that gives a tremendous ability for accounting firms to take on more clients because the same number of staff can process more number of clients' work. Just one more caveat there, though. You know, again, it's not a magic button that will help you do that because it involves systems of the accounting software provider, the banks, the integrator that pulls data from banks and pushes into accounting software. So there are multiple different systems involved. Some of the banks have really older systems. Not everybody has the latest and the best in terms of what they have. So even if 50%, 60% of your clients, you can set up bank feeds, you will see significant amount of efficiency gains. So this leverage is something that you should always target as far as rolling out your CAS offering. So this is the thin line that separates CAS and non-CAS firms. Non-CAS firms are mostly working on after the fact past. You get a bank statement after the month is over, you write up the data into accounting software, you produce financial statements, you bill the client. Anything that is gone, done, you get paid lesser amounts for that. And that's when you want to really make those kinds of work tasks as automated as possible. And this is going to stay. After the fact, it's not going away because many small businesses may not be able to pay higher fees. But the more you move towards doing the work in real time and for the future for your clients, the more you'll get paid. So for future, for example, you might do services like budgeting, cash flow projections and things like that. And now is when you actually process bills and invoices, line up the payments, follow up on receivables, give cash flow projections or, immediate cash flow situations and things like that. The more you work with the clients with now and the future of their businesses, the more you'll get paid. I mean, so I have another example of 1:2. There were firms that said, okay, we used to get about $250, $300 per client for write-up. And we have seen that going up to $550, $600, $750 a month when we started offering CAS. One of our really good customers in New Jersey, he's a CAS master, what we call. So his basic fees is $1,200 a month for CAS clients. We also have another CPA who wrote a book on CFO services, which again is published by CPA Trendlines. Now his firm gets clients $5,000 a month. So $60,000 per agreement. Those kinds of services they offer. So you'll see the upside is tremendous in CAS. Again, depends on your technology skill sets, then your mindset, of course, and the maturity of your processes to offer those CAS services. Then if it all sounds like a rosy picture, the only thing that I need to tell you is this is coming out right from the data that we got from the survey, right from the accountants who told us about this. And they also told us, why CAS is important. And this should be a lead for you, why you should offer CAS if you're not already offering CAS. So this is what came up. This is a little crowded slide, as you can see. And Rick Telberg really cleverly said 6.5 reasons. And I'll tell you why. There are 7 different figures out here. And I put firms that agreed versus firms that disagreed for what happens when you offer CAS. 90% of the firms said CAS is important for the firm's future. They see that more and more automation will take away the standard business of, let's say, write-ups over a period of time. So they need to move up the ladder. So 90%, only 3% disagreed. Firms that were offering CAS already, they saw superior revenue growth compared to their other services, 77% versus 7% that disagreed. CAS provides superior profit margins. And that was 62% of the firm said that. Then we go on to the, we skip the middle one and we say improves client satisfaction. That was 90%. Attracts new clients, 85%, and creates new opportunities, 88%. And then we come in the middle, enhances staff morale, 50%. Now, this was a surprise, so I actually reached out to quite a few firms and figured out. And the most common reason that I got was, while there are measurements in place for the revenue, the cost of getting the revenue, processing, the profitability of the firm, that is all well set in most of the firms, but not necessarily how to measure how staff is feeling about these services. So I guess those staffing and measurements on that front, those processes are yet to mature. So that was the inside that. That's why Rick said this is 6.5. But I believe that it is on the increase because, you know, most of the staff, if you see, if you ever experience that, okay, your staff stays for 2 years, 3 years, and then jump ship. And if you see if they're doing only data processing work most of the time, they don't see much of a value. Yes, initially to get a job and, you know, earning something, and that suddenly becomes not so good feeling once you start doing the same repetitive things. The more you go in CAS, the more you allow your staff to apply minds and help clients. And that's a good feeling that I'm able to help somebody do better. So those are the insights that came in for why CAS. Again, you know, I try to, you know, bring in my own experiences from what I talk on a day-to-day basis with my customers that I service at Accountants World. All of them are accounting firms. So clients who need more services will switch accountants. You know, if you don't offer those additional services, they will switch. This happens all the time. But it's not that they are happy to switch. It's just because they're not getting those additional services when their businesses grow. So that's why you know, you want to stay with those clients who are growing, and you need to start offering those additional services. Clients who are capable of paying more, they will switch. Now, this has been a revelation for me when I talk with many accounting firms. Growing businesses, their ability to pay for more insights is what will make them switch. And if you don't offer that, it's going to be trouble. Even if you offer CAS and you don't bring that to the notice of your clients, look, we're not just providing you financial statements. Here is what it means for you. Here is what decisions you can take out of these financial statements. Then they get to know, oh, yeah, this is good. So let me, you know, start buying those services. Then, you know, if clients come to you for basics and they go to somebody else for higher end services or different services, ultimately they are dealing with two or three accounting or tax or payroll service providers. And ultimately they get tired of, you know, dealing with multiple service providers. So they might switch for that. And then higher fee advisory services emerge from CAS. You cannot take a financial statement that's prepared by somebody else and have an instant understanding of what the client's business is, what the client's mindset is, and how those clients are deciding or not deciding on certain aspects to give them an advice on their business. And when you do the client accounting services, those insights are already building up in your mind when you look at those things daily, weekly. And from there, you go on to advisory services much more easier than, you know, trying to create advisory services without CAS. Then comes, okay, we have the processes, we have the technology, we have good enough understanding, good enough experience of expanding our CAS. So how do you expand your client accounting services market? How do you get more clients? So we asked in the survey, what are the top things that the CAS firms do for marketing of their services? And these are the seven top marketing methods as rated. There were several that we asked. And proactively seeking referrals, you know, that was interesting. Most of the firms said, okay, they get new clients from referrals. Many surveys in the profession will tell you, as high as 94% of the firms say they get new clients mostly from referrals. But proactively seeking referrals is something new, and it is becoming a trend. For example, there's a firm that I know, it's a top 100 firm though, and they have someone in place just to make sure they find that they have the opportunities to get referrals. So what they do is they track, you know, for every client, how many referrals did they give? Maybe once a quarter, that's okay. But if somebody doesn't give them referrals, that person reaches out and says to that client, hey, Mr. Miss, you know, I saw that last 4 months, you know, you haven't referred anyone. Is there something wrong with our services? Is there something more that we can do for you so that you're more happy? And then they say, oh, no, we've got good that you reminded. Actually, I have a friend and like that. So they track it. So that's proactive. There are other things that you can do in, you know, seeking proactive referral, like, you know, sending out an email or letter to all your clients at once and saying, of course, happy clients, you should know who they are, and ask for more referrals, and you get them. Then firm's website, this is obvious, but it's increasing. But at the same time, it's only 48% said that firm's website brings them new clients. So why is that? One of the things is many firms have so-called canned websites. Is the same. If you, you know, if you do a search on Google and say, you know, the best accounting firms, a why accounting firm, and you'll see, you know, responsiveness, promptness, and those kinds of reasons coming up like a million times. And if everybody says the same thing, how do clients differentiate? So the website can be made more effective by sharing more content relevant to your prospects and things like that. It might be a little bit of work, but you can make that better. Networking. This is pre-COVID figure. So even then it was at 39% because it involves time. And now there's a lot of online networking. So it should be interesting to see how this figure keeps changing. By the way, the survey is constantly open. People can still submit responses. So I would expect these figures to change over a period of time. Search engine optimization is where you hire some technologists to, you know, do certain things in the back end of your website to, you know, you pay for certain keywords and things like that. Not too many. I mean, I personally don't do this too much about search engine optimization, because if you share good content, Google has great algorithms to find out whose content is the best. And it, you know, it kind of gets you there. Thought leadership, that's what I was just about telling. So this one, although it's at 12%, this is a huge opportunity of content and thought leadership. You don't really need too much of a writing capability or creativity to get this done. If you have a good number of clients, you know, if you start noting down what questions they ask and try to find out why they ask those questions, you can figure out, you know, what is it that the clients are looking for, and then you know, create a content piece around it. And that's what, you know, gets you a little more visibility on Google as well as, you know, your thought leadership. Then influencers and social media marketing. So you basically, you know, utilize other people's networks to go after, you know, the client seeking objectives of yours. And then this is interesting again. 11% firms said they have one person identified to grow the CAS segment of their firm. So we call them the CAS champion. And what happens is this person's responsibility is not just looking at processes, but also overall, how do you grow this CAS segment? So it's always good to really deploy one person who is responsible for CAS segment of your firm. Then comes to, you know, I have so many clients. How do I know which clients will ultimately buy my CAS services? Because they're going to be a little more, you know, they have to pay more. And they have to. It has to make sense for those clients to you know, buy those additional services. So here are some, you know, key indicators that you can track amongst your clients. You go into your clients' books and find out how many transactions on an average they have per month, how many customers they have, if their customers are spread all over a geography, how many vendors they have, how many employees they have. Do they have a lot of money stuck in inventory and WIP, work in progress? What are their payment terms? You know, do they sell and get paid instantly, or do they get their payments after 30 days, 60 days? Or when they buy, are they required to pay only after some time? So that's another thing. So basically what it means is when payment terms are like that, you're looking at cash flow management services and bill payments, payables and receivables management services. And then of course you want to see the growth trend of each client. And if the client is stuck at the same levels for a long time and you don't see much of a growth, so obviously they're not going to be requiring any of those additional CAS services. And then I looked at which industries or niches are really growing in the country. There's a great source on Bureau of Labor Statistics. It gives you the projections of next 10 years, which industries are likely to grow and employ how many people over the next 10 years and the growth trend and percentages and things like that. But again, if you marry that with this kind of KPIs or indicators, you will see that construction and related suppliers and service providers, they will have lots of transactions and lots of inventory that they need to allocate to different clients. Restaurants and hospitality, even though you might feel with COVID, lots of restaurants might have closed. I was really surprised when I spoke with some of the largest restaurant accounting firms that are our customers in accounting power at Accountants World. They said they actually were growing during all these pandemic months. And they actually said, maybe once the pandemic is over, the business will go down for restaurants. And I'm like, how does that happen? And so look, most of the people are at home, working from home. And the local restaurants are doing great business in residential areas. Now, once people start going back to work, is the city or downtown restaurants, those businesses will go up. So that was an interesting insight that came from that industry. Manufacturing, related suppliers, service providers, again, the same thing, lots of moving parts in those businesses. Not necessarily go to very large manufacturing companies. There are so many vendors that supply internal SKU parts and things like that. So again, there could be opportunities. Healthcare is always the number one industry to go after, because that is where a lot of wealth lies. If you look at the top most paying professions in the country, you will find among the top 30, at least 17 are related to healthcare. So those are the people in healthcare that are making a lot of money, and hence they need a lot of accounting services. Technology is always going to be there. So lots of startups in technology, and startups, I don't mean, people working from their dorms, but, people who are funded, people who got venture capital funding, seed funding, millions of dollars. And those firms, those technology companies require far better accounting, because ultimately their aim is to grow. And to do that, they need to convince the investors about their viability. And that comes from the accounting and financial statements and ratios and things like that. Nonprofits is another. There's a lot of compliance requirement for nonprofits. Plenty of donations that come in. You need to do that accounting very, very properly. Ton of transactions, again, number of transactions. And real estate, again, the number of transactions is very, very high in that. So these are just examples. You can always look around, around your geography, which are the businesses that are growing, show some trends, and those are the firms. How do you offer services to them, though? You need some kind of expertise in that. So if you already have, let's say, 25, 30 clients, and maybe 10 of them belong to an industry or a related industry, that's your best bet to, take your expertise from working with those clients and start offering that to attract similar clients. So this is something that many accounting firms do that offer CAS. If you go to any top 100 firm, forget the top four, of course, they're giant, powerhouses. But if you go to any top 100 firm, and you will see the services that they offer are always categorized as to industries we serve. You'll see a section on their website. And you will see 5, 10 top industries that they service. They have extreme expertise in that. So that's another way to look at what you should be doing to identify the CAS fit clients. There are many more CAS insights to share. I have included a lot of links in these slides. The PDF of the slides that has been handed out also contains this link. So you can just go in and click on those. There are ton more CAS articles right from CPA Trendlines. I've written lots of other articles about CAS and other things. Those links are also there. And I definitely recommend that you look at, you know, going pro with CPA Trendlines. One thing that I got to know when I met Rick Telberg for the first time about 8 years ago, that CPA Trendlines is not an advertorial website, which means you wouldn't see, you know, vendors' advertisements all over the place in the content and all that. And all the content that is provided by CPA Trendlines is not like news alone. You know, new tax law came, PPP came, things like those are, of course, are covered, but it's all coming in from lots of experts and influencers and thought leaders from the profession. And all that insight is extremely valuable. And that's a very big differentiating factor for CPA Trendlines. And one of the things that I started writing more for CPA Trendlines was this fact that the insight that I can share will be shared with the audience without any commercial packaging of it. So that gives a great chance of me to connect with more accountants and get their feedback, their insights, and things like that. So with that, I tried to cover as fast as possible. I know there could be questions, and you might want to dive deeper onto some of those things. So Rick, I'm almost done with what I had to say as fast as I could. So if there's any questions, definitely would want to look at them.
Atendra, thank you for a terrific presentation. You covered a ton of ground with a lot of facts and moved very quickly through it. Congratulations and thank you for a terrific presentation.